Alright, so how many of you guys were here last year for spiritual emphasis week? Raise your hand. How many of you guys really loved the team from Coastlands who came and spoke to us all week? And raise your hand if you are a new student and you're like, what's going on, Chapel on Monday? Alright, so this is Spiritual Emphasis Week, and Spiritual Emphasis Week is all about spiritual emphasis. So, we are going to be having a chapel every day this week, and Mr. Huffman is going to bring us some great messages from the Word of God, and we're going to have some time to worship and a lot of fun. And some of you have already seen them in your Bible classes, so they're going to be doing the same thing they did last year, with answering some questions and doing some journaling with some of the older kids. And as you guys remember, probably I knew these guys back when I was in your position, right? And so they made an impact in my life, and so it's my pleasure to bring them here and let you guys experience their ministry as well. All right, so with that, I will hand it over to Dr. Brady.
Well, welcome to your own school. As you can see, I've come to you with my bare feet. Aren't they fabulous? They look like real bare feet. They're the black bear kind. And yes, those are my feet. They don't get any bigger. That's it. And I'm doing that for two reasons. One, some of you might be thinking, holy ground, right? Moses took his shoes off because God was speaking to him. And you can just sit in a gymnasium and think about push-ups, or you can believe God's going to speak to you this week. Now, I don't suggest you all take your shoes off, but mine are off because I'm believing God's going to speak through us and to you, and I'm believing we are also going to hear from you. So that's why we're here. Also, it's always a good idea to bear your soul in chapel. Bear your soul. I'm Dr. Pam Brady. This is Mr. Huffman. Mr. Huffman is our teacher this week. Miss Cassie, who I remember from last year, please wave. And our student intern this year is Miss Emily Now from Weymouth, right here in your own great city. So let's open in a word of prayer. Lord, I have bare feet because I'm bearing my soul. And honestly, we can come expecting to hear from you, or we can be thinking about push-ups or anything else. Lord, will you come and have your way this week? Come and use us to be vessels emptied of ourselves, filled with the things of God and poured out for each other. Thank you that I have come expecting to hear from you through these young people. Your word says in Colossians 1:27, Christ in you, the hope of glory. And Lord, as I look at these faces and as we talk to each other, I want to hear from you too. Come and move in my life, change me, and open me to your plans and purposes. In Jesus' name, amen. Mr. Huffman.
All right, those of you that were here last week, you may remember that every day in chapel, we started out with object classes. Anybody remember what they were about? Remember? What was that? The facade, that'll be coming later. Object lessons, yes. The candle object lessons. And what we're going to do this year, we're not going to do candles, we're going to do something different. This year, we're going to do something that we have called Always Prepared. So say Always Prepared.
Always Prepared.
That was not too bad for a Monday after Thanksgiving. Say Always Prepared.
Always Prepared.
Nice job. And these are going to be things that I or another team member must have to be prepared for whatever we like to do. So the ones that you're going to hear from me this week are all going to relate to things I like to do, such as hiking, camping, backpacking, kayaking, and so on. So this morning, what we're going to start out with is this one. I'm going to put it on first of all. I think most of you are going to know what this is. How many of you guys have one of these? Have one? All right, several of you have one. This is called a... It's called a headlamp. Say headlamp.
Headlamp.
Now, I always mistake this if I'm going backpacking or if I'm going camping, because I can take my flashlight, and I can take my flashlight too, but in many ways this is easier because it keeps your hands free. You don't have to hold onto the flashlight, which means you have a hand for whatever else you need it for. And one of the things that I can do with this is I can take it, most of them are like this, I think, and you can turn it down. Can I turn it on? And I have it turned down. So if I decide, a couple years ago, Ms. Cassie and a group of us, we did a sunrise hike on Mount Major in New Hampshire near Alton Bay, and we did the sunrise hike, and you needed this, right? Because it was pitch black out still, because we're trying to get to the top of the mountain by sunrise, and you needed the headlamp to see where you were going. What you use this for is I want to make sure that I don't trip over any roots. I want to make sure that I'm not going to step into some giant mud puddle and splash myself and the people around me, all of it would be kind of fun. I need to make sure I'm not going to step into another hole. This helps me know where to walk. And there's a verse in the Bible that this always reminds me of. It's a fairly short verse, and it's Psalm 119, which is ironically the longest chapter in the Bible, right? But it's a verse you might be familiar with, because some of you grew up at this school, and some of you grew up saying the pledges. All right, so let's see if you can fill it in. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will... Excellent, nice job, it's right up there. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light unto my path. You say it, you've memorized it, you know the pledge, you've said it every day, some of you. But I want to challenge you this morning, do you make God's word a light unto your, a lamp to your feet and light unto your path? Do you make his word that? See, that's what this is, right? This helps me know where to walk, and it helps me to know where not to walk, so that I can get to where I want to go. Do you make that God's word for you? See, that's the purpose of this. But you just have that verse memorized because it was part of the pledge you said for years? Or is it actually true for you? So I'm going to have you fill in the blanks. We'll say it again. Have you fill in the blanks. Your word is a to my feet and a to my path. Psalm 119:105. I'll be wearing this throughout the day. I encourage you to be thinking about what does God's word matter in your life? Does it matter? Maybe for some of you it doesn't. You need to be honest about that. It's okay to be honest. I want to encourage you to be honest in Bible classes, right? It's okay to be honest. Or is God's word, his light, that shows you where to go, where not to go, so you get to ultimately where you want to be.
Let him see the real you.
she'll remember it.
All right, your handouts. Handouts will be coming around. I've learned it's pointless for me to teach you all. I will quiz you though, while they're coming around. Meredith got it right about the candles from last year, way to go. Your quiz now is, what was the word that we spelled out last year? Nice, well done. You spelled out the word hope, and you saw the word hope in both of those songs. And I told you last year that that's really our prayer, is that that's where you find hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him. It's still as true this year as it was last year. Everybody have the handouts? Well, I'll come to the other side. Whether or not you, whatever you choose to do with these, keep them, put them in your Bible, burn them, that's totally up to you. The only thing I ask you to not do is not leave them in here for us to pick up afterwards. That's the only thing I ask. All right, so we're not spelling out the word hope this year because we spelled out the word hope last year. The word we are spelling out this year is lead. We're going to spell out the word lead because our theme for this year is called Lead Useful Lives. And I want to tell you why I picked this. One of the things I like to do in the summer is I like to, just on a nice evening, if I just need to get out, I'm working all day, I'll just go through a walk in the neighborhood. But one of the things I've noticed is when I go through a walk in the neighborhood in the evening, and you walk past the different houses on the different streets, when you can see in the front window, what do you always see in the evenings in somebody's house? I'm not being a stalker, I'm not being a creeper, but what do I see? Yep. What was that? The TV on, right? The TV on. No matter how many houses you walk past, nearly every house has the TV on. And I just think when I walk through the neighborhoods, I ask this question, is this all there is to life? Literally, how many of our lives are, you know what, get up in the morning, go to school, come home, maybe do homework, maybe have dinner, then sit down and watch TV for the rest of the evening and then go to bed and repeat? Maybe yours looks a little bit different. Maybe there are video games involved instead of TV and Netflix instead of whatever. But how many of our lives just go through that routine where that's just what we do? And I sit there and I walk those streets and I think, is this all that there is? Is this really all that there is? And over the summer, I came across a quote. It was in a letter between a guy named James Madison. Have you ever heard of James Madison? President of the United States. It was a letter between James Madison before he became president and an attorney general named William Bradford, not the William Bradford of Plymouth Plantation, but a different William Bradford. And they're writing back and forth. And one of the things that I learned over the summer was that they both had gone to Princeton University. And when they were at Princeton University, they were at Princeton, hopefully, it's one of the Ivy League schools. Yes, no? Yes? Okay, some of you. Princeton University, Ivy League School in New Jersey. And the president at that time, when they were both students there, was a man named John Witherspoon. And one of the things I came across in Bradford's letter to Madison was that when they were at Princeton, John Witherspoon, who was a Scottish minister, in their chapels at Princeton when it was still a Christian college, Witherspoon would often pray this. He would pray, God, spare useful lives. That was Witherspoon's prayer in chapel at Princeton University in the 1700s. God, spare useful lives. What does he mean by that? Don't curse people who are doing useful things. What's that? Don't let them die so quick, right? God, let them, if they're living useful lives for you and for your kingdom, God, let them live to be old age. And I thought about that, about Witherspoon's prayer, spare useful lives. And what's the question I began to think about and ask? What do you think? What's the question it should cause us to ask? How do we make our lives useful? And even before that, is my life useful to God and to His kingdom? See, that's the question I had. Am I living a useful life? And around the same time, I got something in the mail from, it was a Christian ministry, and they have like curriculum and stuff, and nothing I was going to order, but this question was on the back of it. And it says this: if God, who is in charge of my days, has allowed me to keep living my life, why? I want you to think about that for a minute. If God, who is in charge of your days, has allowed you to keep living your life, why? Why are you here? Why has He kept you here? Why has God spared your life up to this point? And so just thinking about all these things, walking through the neighborhoods and seeing the TVs on night after night after night, and wondering, is this all there is? Is this what our lives have become? Is all that God has for us? And reading about Witherspoon praying in Princeton's chapel, God, spare useful lives. And coming across that question, if God, who's in charge of my days, has allowed me to keep on living, why? Because He doesn't have to. And so that's where our theme comes from this year. It comes from Witherspoon's prayer, where we're actually going to spell out, lead useful lives. And this verse in Psalm 39, I still need to fix that statement, Psalm 39, is our theme verse for the week. But it always makes me think, so you can repeat it after me, Psalm 39, 4.
Psalm
39, 4. What's that week? Psalm 39, 4.
Psalm 39, 4.
Show me, O Lord.
Show me, O Lord.
My life's end.
My life's end.
And the number of my days.
And the number of my days.
Let me know how fleeting is my life.
Let me know how fleeting is my life.
Psalm 39, 4.
Psalm 39,
4. See, because when you get a hold of the fact that your life is fast, no matter how old you live to be, it changes the way you live. Seventh graders, we had you this morning in coffee can, and I shared with you about that seventh grader who has cancer in the Worcester area, in another Christian school we go to. When you know that your time is fast and fleeting and short, it changes the way that you live because your priorities are different. I was thinking this morning, one of our focuses in New England, what is our God in New England? What was that? Tom Brady, right? Let's get that out there. See that picture on the left? See Tom Brady there in his Jesus uniform, Jesus robe, with his sheep, right? You're right. Tom Brady is our God in New England. I got this email from a church that I was attending before and it said this: so sorry for the last minute decision. We've decided it's best to cancel the picnic as well as reschedule the congregational meeting that was to take place this weekend. Not only were we competing with a Patriots game scheduled for that day. Really? This is to a church congregation. We can't even compete with Tom Brady on a Sunday afternoon. Just being honest, right? Which should we get more excited about? God or the Pets game? Let's just be honest. I was thinking this morning, we have Christian brothers and sisters around the world who are our family, who are persecuted, and some of whom will probably not make it through the day in certain countries. And the first thing I did this morning when I got up was what? Checked who won the game. Right? Because how many of us care more about what the score was last night and whether or not Gronkowski is going to be out for the rest of the season and how's that going to affect the Pats season than we care about our family members around the world who are persecuted for their faith, if we're honest. So I want to talk to you this morning about leading useful lives. We're going to do a little comparison between Tom Brady and somebody in the Bible. This video clip was on 60 Minutes and back in 2005. It was after the Patriots had won their third Super Bowl. And I want you to listen. What I want you to think about when you watch this video clip is, what does Tom Brady have that most guys would love to have? There's a list of things. We'll watch the video clip, and then you give me a list of things based upon what he has.
Brady is forward.
All right, let's list them. What does he have that guys want? Start with one thing. Give me one thing. Yes, Elijah. Fame, right? He's famous. Everyone wants for 15 minutes of fame. They want 500 Instagram followers, and they want 100 Instagram, 1,000 Instagram followers. Fame, we want fame, yes. Money, right? $60 million contract for playing football.
Excellent.
How many of you would like, what was that? What'd you say?
Sex
appeal, right? He's attractive, right? He has the ladies going along with the sex appeal. He has girlfriends, and a wife, right? Supermodel girlfriend, supermodel wife. Now I want you to stop and think. What else does he have? He does, but you, yeah. What was that? Super Bowl rings. Guys want to be good athletes, many of them. They wish that they could play NFL football. Yes. Right, talent, right? So look at this list. I don't want you guys to think as guys and ladies, you know. I want you to personalize this. This man has fame. He has athletic ability. In 2005, he had a $60 million contract. Supermodel girls and wives, wife. And yet, what does he say? Does he, what was that?
Doubt?
Does he sound satisfied? No! Some people would say, hey man, it is what it is. You've reached your goal, your dream, your... Me? I say it's gotta be more than this. How can you be, he was 28 in that video. How can you be 28 and have all that stuff and then still say, this is it? The thing is, it's not going to satisfy you. Do you relate to running after any of the things that he has that we just listed? Money, girls, fame, athletic ability. You're going to find the same thing that he finds. He has a lot more of it than probably any of you will ever have. And then he still says, that's it. So let's look at Solomon. We're going to do a little comparison with Solomon because Solomon says something very similar. And when you hear multiple people in a similar situation who are always saying the same thing, maybe you might think, well, maybe there's some wisdom in what they're saying. Maybe that's true. So Solomon says this in Ecclesiastes chapter 2. He said, I said to myself, if you're not familiar, depending on how much Bible you know, Solomon, wisest man ever, king of Israel, David's son, pretty much everything you possibly have in life. That's who he is. I said to myself, come now, I will test you with pleasure to find out what is good. So what's he going to do? What did he just say? He's going to test, find out what is good. What's good? What should you as middle schoolers, high schoolers be pursuing? Solomon kind of ran that test. Let's find out what is good. But that also proved to be meaningless. Laughter, I said, is madness, and what does pleasure accomplish? I tried cheering myself with wine and embracing folly, my mind still guiding me with wisdom. I wanted to see what was good for people to do under the heavens during the few days of their lives. That's his test. Is there a more important question for you to ask? What is worthwhile for you to do as an 8th grader? Or as a 10th grader? Or as a 7th grader? What is worthwhile for you to do under the few days of your life? Is there a more important question than that? That's what Solomon is setting out to do. Number one is pleasure. Number one, you know, yes, you don't have enough time to talk. Okay, number one is pleasure. What is worthwhile for me to do under heaven during the few days of my life? Have you ever asked that to yourself, that question? Or are you now? I don't want you to answer this out loud, I just want you to think about it. How would you answer that question? What is worthwhile for you to do under heaven during the few days of your life? I undertook great projects. Let's go back a minute. What's the first one? He said, I tried cheering myself with what? With wine, right? I tried cheering myself with wine. Also known as, to make it a more general term, alcohol, right? Let's put it in modern terms. Not just alcohol, but people try what all the time? Drugs, right? Why? Because they want to experience the feeling of that. They want to know what it's like. They want to know what it feels like. And in many cases, they're trying to fill a void. And many times, people who use drugs are trying to escape from something painful that they've been through. And if they're high, they can get away from it for a while. But then they eventually come back down and they're stuck back in their life, so what do they have to do? Do it again, to escape again. People try to fill it all the time with that. I tried sharing myself with wine. Let's go to the next one. I undertook great projects. I built houses for myself and planted vineyards. I made gardens and parks and planted all kinds of fruit trees in them. I made reservoirs to water groves of flourishing trees. I bought male and female slaves and had other slaves who were born in my house. Let's go back to the first part of that. Projects. Where do a lot of guys find their identity? And this is something that you have to be on guard against as you get older. Power, that's true, which often comes through their work. Guys are notorious. Ladies can be this too. Some ladies are like this too. Being sexist, can be both. But work can become your life. There are plenty of students who grow up where mom and dad are still together, but dad is rarely around because dad is working all the time. And sometimes it's to provide for the basic things on the table, but sometimes it's just for more money to have the bigger house, the newer car, the more expensive vacations, and guys can find their identity in their work. Ladies can too. And you see Solomon, I undertook great projects. I planted this, I built that, I made that. I bought male and female slaves and had other slaves who were born in my house. I also owned more herds and flocks than anyone in Jerusalem before me. I amassed silver and gold for myself and the treasure of kings and provinces that would be brought to him. What's that about? What's that part about? What did Solomon have? Money, stuff. He's got it all. Remember, he's the king of Jerusalem. He's the king of Israel. He's got more than anybody's ever had. People come to him to see his great wealth and everything he has there. And they bring more stuff to him. He's got it all. I acquired male and female singers. What could we label that under? Male and female singers. Begins with an E. It's a word. Entertainment, right? We entertain ourselves to death. And if we don't have entertainment, we are bored. We're always looking to entertain ourselves. That's why we spend hours on YouTube. That's why we watch whole seasons of Netflix in a weekend. Alright? But what are we trying to do? We're trying to entertain ourselves. Because we're bored and have nothing better to do. Not that we don't have anything better to do. Listen, it's not that you don't have anything better to do. It's that you're choosing not to do something better. Entertainment is a nice default because I don't have to do anything. I can just sit there and be entertained and watch. Is that why God has you here? Question on that card that I read? If God, who is in charge of my days, I'm still here, why? do that. And a harem as well. Not going to look for a definition of harem, because I don't know what will come out of people's mouths. A harem is basically lots of women that he can have sex with. Tom Brady has supermodel girlfriends, supermodel wife. Solomon had a harem. How many of us are focused on, obsessed, not just focused on, but obsessed with relationships? How many of us are addicted to stuff on the internet? Which kind of crosses over between entertainment and the girl stuff. We know this is real. And girls too, by the way. The delights of a man's heart. I became greater by far than anyone in Jerusalem before me. In all this, my wisdom stayed with me. I denied myself nothing my eyes desired. I refused my heart no pleasure. My heart took delight in all my labor, and this was the reward for all my toil. How many of you would like, don't raise your hand, just for you to think about, how many of you would like to have Tom Brady's life? Money, girls, fame, sports. How many of you would like to have Solomon's life? Money, entertainment, women, projects, wealth. And how many of you would like to try this? Man, I'd like to find out what made me happy. I wish I could try every single thing that they just listed, both of them. I'd like to do that. I bet there are very few people in here who wouldn't want to try this experiment. Because what do you think? Because you think that if you could try it, then what? It'll work. Listen, stop for a minute. I want you to think about that for a minute. If I could try it, what?
It'll work.
It'll work. That's what we all think, if we're honest. So two is pursuits. Life, work projects, wealth, entertainment, women. What's his conclusion? What does he come to at the end? I denied myself no pleasure, wish we all could try that experiment. He says this, yet when I surveyed all that my hands had done, and what I had toiled to achieve, everything was meaningless. I'm chasing after the wind. What's the problem with chasing after the wind? You're not going to catch it, ever. A chasing after the wind. Nothing was gained under the sun. You hear Tom Brady say it. Some people say, hey man, it is what it is. I reached my goal, my dream, my... Me? Say, it's got to be more than this. Solomon, I did this, I did this, I had this, I tried that, I tried the other thing. Everything is meaningless. I'm chasing after the wind. Are there any of these things that you're chasing after? Because, let's be honest, it makes you happy. For now. Right? I mean, let's be honest. These things will make you happy. Am I saying that these things won't make you happy? No. They will make you happy. That's why we do them. Can we just get that out there? That's why we do these things. That's why people use drugs. That's why we look stuff on the internet. That's why we want a college degree in this so we can make all kinds of money. Because it will make me happy. For a time. But in the end, you're going to reach the same point that Solomon reached and that Tom Brady reached. Create his perspective. We already talked about this. Because everything he did lacked eternal value and only brought him short-term pleasure, leaving him empty at the end. See, it's short-term. Because you always need the next thing. You always need the next fix. You always need the next electronic device. You're always in the next whatever. Pleasure always makes promises that it can't and won't keep. It won't give you ultimate meaning, and it won't satisfy your soul. When the end of your time on this earth approaches, how will any of these things help you or prepare you for eternity? That's the future we all face. Put this up here. The fool learns from nobody's experience. The ordinary man learns from his own experience. But the wise man learns from others' experience. Which of those three are you going to be? When I was a teacher, I taught in Nashua, New Hampshire, at a Christian school there. I had a student named Thomas. In seventh grade, Thomas basically, his life revolved around girls and friends. That was his life. I remember being at my desk one time. I don't remember what Thomas was trying to convince me to do or whatever. But I remember him saying this. He's standing at my desk, a seventh grade guy. He says, "Come on, Mr. Huffman, you're only young once." And for Thomas, that meant girls and parties. Years went by, he left after seventh or eighth grade, years went by. I go to Nashua, get my tires replaced. I'm up there at the counter to pay. Guy who replaced my tires comes out from the garage, and he called me Mr. Huffman. Now keep in mind I haven't seen him since seventh or eighth grade. He comes out, and once he said Mr. Huffman, I looked again and realized it was Thomas. And so we spent some time catching up, and I'll never forget this. He was getting ready to join the military. And I asked him, "Yeah, well, what made you want to join the military? Why are you thinking of joining?" And this is what he said, word for word. He said, "I woke up one night and realized I was 21. And changing tires. I woke up one night and realized I was 21 and changing tires. There was nothing wrong with changing tires." But that seventh grader that stood before me saying, "You're only young once," and for him that meant girls and parties, it led him to a point of saying, "That's it. I want my life to be more." So that's my challenge for you this morning. Right. You've all got it, because we all do. The question is, what's the problem? You're not going to fit. This one? No, it's not going to fit. I keep trying a different one, he says. Does that fit? No. This one? Try a new one. One more. How about you? No, this one's for you. You know, it doesn't fit. This is for you to think about. What is it for you? Because the thing is, ultimately, you get the point, all right? It's the only piece that fits. Learn from Solomon. I'll stand for learn from Solomon. Say learn from Solomon.
Learn from Solomon.
Say learn from Tom Brady. I don't care which one you learn it from, the lessons to say. Just close in prayer, know you're hungry. Volunteer to pray. The sooner you pray, the sooner you can eat. Must be their fasting. Thank you. Thanks, Mason.